Welcome to our Sunday service. We're so glad and excited for having you today. What is such a privilege to have you. We love you so much and we love each one of you today to join us. May the presence of God be with us as we are worshiping. Let's worship together. Somebody here? Do you know that? Oh yes. Blessing and honor, glory and power, be unto the ancient of days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the ancient of days. Oh yes, Lord. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory, and be the hymn that bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall pass away, O Ancient of Days. Oh yes, Lord. Blessing and honor, glory and power, be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Oh yes, Lord. Every tongue you'll ever know shall declare your glory, every knee shall bow in your throne. In the world shall exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall pass away, O Ancient of Days. Oh yes. Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth,
all the earth.
Singing to the
on heaven's mercy seat.
creation I see. Praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Holy,
holy, holy, holy, still, O God Almighty. Oh, what a distance and distance, O God.
God Almighty reigns.
Praise the Lord, my dear friends. Welcome to another episode of Walk Talk, where we talk about our walk with Jesus. I want to encourage you today and let you know that Jesus is above everything that you're facing in your life. Anything and everything that you feel that is uncontrollable by you, I want you to know that Jesus is in control of everything. Amen. And I just want to share with you briefly from a story in the Bible. It talks about Jesus getting into the boat with his disciples when the storm hits. It's found in Mark chapter 4, verse 35 onwards. And this, I want you to just understand this. If you read that whole chapter, you would see that they had an amazing time, parable after parable, a great outdoor meeting. And then what happens? Jesus says, hey, let's get on the boat. Let's go to the other side. And then after that, we see that he says, I'm getting in the boat with you. So it's, as far as I am concerned, out of my understanding, out of my limited understanding, we could call that to be the will of God. Am I right? They were not doing anything wrong. They were not sinning. They were not running away from God. Well, they had an amazing crusade. They had a Jesus Christ crusade. I'm sure there was great food there. And after that, they said, let's go to the other side. And Jesus says, you do it. So they obeyed what Jesus said. And Jesus said, I'm coming with you too. So they are in God's will. And Jesus is sitting in the center of that. And suddenly, there is a storm. The lesson that we learn out of that, my dear friends, is that no matter whether you feel that you are in the center of God's will, a storm can hit your life. Amen? A storm can hit your life at any given time. As believers, sometimes we have this notion that if we're not with God, if you're not in right relationship with God, then something bad happens, because we always pose the question to Jesus, God, why is this happening? What did I do? Why me? I loved you. I went to church. I gave my tithes and my offerings. Why is this happening to me? I want to let you know that the reason why the storm came was for Jesus to reestablish his relationship with you. So what do we have here? We have three kinds of storms that are happening. One is a circumstance. Maybe you're facing one right now. A circumstance that you feel you cannot control, like the storm. You cannot stop it even if you want to, like a storm in your life. A storm that you feel is going to kill you, like it felt, made the disciples feel. Second, it led them to fear, because when Jesus gets up and he says, "Why are you afraid?" So this storm in your life, it leads you to fear. That's the second kind of storm in your life. And the third is the theological storm, which is, they ask the question, "Jesus, why are you not waking up?" Many of us ask that question, which in other words means, "Jesus, do you not see what I'm going through? Jesus, do you not see the storm that is hitting my life? Do you not see what I am going through in this part of my life?" And Jesus asks the question, "Why are you afraid? Where is your faith?" You may feel, it may feel that, "God, do you not know what's happening in my life? Do you not know what financial, family, personal, psychological problem I'm going through? I think I'm going to die, and you're asking me why I'm afraid. Don't you know why I'm afraid?" But today I want to encourage you is, think about this, and I want to end. When there was trouble in your boat, when there was trouble in your life, when there was a storm that hit your boat, many of us, we let the circumstance determine who is going to be the leader. We ask everybody, think about this, when you have a problem in your life, you go ask your dad, you ask your mom, you ask your friend, you ask your husband, you ask your wife, you ask the people, you ask all kinds of people, help me, I need some money, I don't have a job, but can you hook me up a little bit? Can you give me a jack? Can you do this? Can you do that for me? But do we even once wake up God who's sitting in our boat? That's the question that I want to pose in front of you, my dear friends. The storm is raging in your life that will kill you. But the only thing that you need to do is go wake up Jesus in your life. Hallelujah. Wake him up. And you see, when he wakes up in your life, he will calm the storm with one word. My dear friends, that's the word of encouragement I want to give you today. Stop depending on people. Stop depending on your family. Stop depending even on your churches or your pastors or your mentors or the people who may lead you there. That's all great. But when you are hit with a storm, you need to wake up Jesus. You know why? Because if you see in verse 35, he said, "Let us go to the other side." He didn't say, "Let me go to the other side." You will know that God's promises are yes and amen. Many times when the circumstance hits us, we forget God's promises in our life. He said, "Let us go to the other side." So I want to tell you today, if he has said it, he will do it. If he said he will do it, he will take you through it. No matter what you think, no matter what the circumstance looks, no matter how big the storm looks in your life, if he has said it, he will do it. Wake him up in your life. Wake him up through prayer. Wake him up through meditating the Word of God. And you will see that Jesus is over and above every problem that you are facing in your life. God bless.
I greet you all in the matchless name of the Lord Jesus Christ. My dear friends, we have gathered together again on this, the Lord's Day, to worship our living Savior. It is always a joy and a privilege for us to glorify the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe that you agree with me. 22 has gone. 23, we have stepped in, and here we are in the second month of the year 2023. So many challenges around us. So many problems that we face. But in spite of all this, the great news is that the Lord is with us, who has promised us that he will never leave us. He will never forsake us. So many powerful promises of divine protection upon our life. Even if your mother forgets you, I will not forget you, says the Lord. Every hair of your head is numbered. You cannot make your hair white or black. You cannot increase your stature, your height. It's all given by God. And God's promises always remains the same, remains fruitful. It'll never, ever fail. That is the greatest blessing we have. We walk with Him. We trust in Him. Our eyes are upon Him. The Bible says, just like a servant's eyes are upon his master, like a maid's eyes are upon her mistress, our eyes are upon Him. And the good news is that His eyes are upon us. He watches over us. India is not that great, kind towards Christianity these days. The powerful forces are fighting against us. But in spite of that, Jesus is reminding us that He is the Lord of India. Do you believe that? God has been gracious to us in places like Kerala, where we still have the freedom to worship. Nobody is coming with sticks and steel rods in their hands, coming into a church building on a Sunday morning, breaking down the sound system, beating up the pastor. It's not happening here yet. But I live in Delhi, and I've got churches all over India, and so many places where the worship is not free anymore. There's no freedom. So many challenges. During the last Christmas, many of our pastors were summoned to the police stations, almost threatened that you cannot conduct your church services in the new year the way that you have been doing before. Sometimes you wonder, is that the time that the freedom of the church is going to come to an end in our country? Or are we going to the places where the iron curtains of the communist nations, where the church became an underground church? We don't know. But the Bible says, as long as the day is there, we'll do the work of God. Because Jesus said, but the night is coming that no man can work. But night is not here yet. We still have the day, the sun is still shining. Let us continue on serving the Lord and worshiping our living Savior. And God will bless us. Hallelujah. So, why I'm saying all these things? A privilege to come and worship God together is an amazing privilege. Do not treat it lightly in your life. Coming to the church on a Sunday morning, sitting down and clapping your hands, singing praises unto the Lord is an amazing, amazing privilege, my dear friends. Enjoy it. Worship your Lord. He loves to enjoy the worship of God's people. Amen? Today I want to share with you a thought that God has put in my heart for you. I want you to look with me from the book of James, chapter 1. I'm going to read 2-3 verses in chapter 1. We'll read from verse 6, 7, and 8. And it reads like this, but let him ask in faith with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. Verse 7. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. Verse 8. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. I want to reverse and read it because it comes down from 6. And in verse 8, it tells the real reason why this man will not receive any blessing from God. So let us read from verse 8 and go back to 7. It says, he is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. And then verse 7, it says, but for let not that man, who is that man? The man who is double-minded. And let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. So that's my message for you today. A double-minded man. He is unstable in all his ways. Who is a double-minded man? What does that mean? Iduman Solovan. That's what in Malayalam it says. What is being double-minded? Double-mindedness means you cannot make up your mind. You don't know where you are going. You don't want to know. You do things that you don't plan to do. You have no focus in your life. You're getting down from Tiruvalla and you're standing on the road wondering, where am I going to go? You go to the bus stand. You're thinking of going to Kottayam and the bus comes and stops and it is going to Chengannur. You get into the bus. Why? Because you don't have a goal in your life. Your mind is not set. The Bible says, blessed is the man whose mind is set on the Lord. Your mind is not set. You cannot make up your mind. He's a double-minded man. And people from every category belongs to this place of double-mindedness. Not only the believers, not only small local pastors, great leaders, presidents, superintendents, general secretaries, central pastors, many people who claim to be working for the Lord for many years have got this problem. They cannot make up their mind. They don't know what they're going to do with the call of God upon their life. The element of faith is not there. They're worried so much about their life. So many challenges that comes across in their life. And they're running away from God's plan. The question today is, as you're listening to me, are you a double-minded man? Do you have a focus? Do you know where you're going? Do you know what is going to happen to you in tomorrow? Can you face challenges in your life? Can you say to yourself, I will not run away, but I will stand as a rock? Amen? If you look at the opposite of this verse, what does it say? It'll say something like this. A single-minded man is stable in all his ways. And that man will receive everything from the Lord. Can you say amen to that? All we need is a change from double-mindedness and move to single-mindedness. That means, what does it mean? It means you have a focus in your life. The Bible says, when Jesus was going to Jerusalem, he was going to Bethany. Lazarus is dead. The Bible says, he set his mind like a flint. Flint is a sharp rock, okay? So he has set his mind like a sharp rock. Nothing was going to deviate his ways. He's going to go. He's going to face death. He's going to face the tears of the sisters, Mary and Martha. He's going to face the people of that village. He set his mind and he's focused in whatever he was going to do. Do you know that people will not trust double-minded people? You can never be a leader with a double-mindedness. Why? Because you cannot make up your mind. How can I follow a leader who does not know where he is going? Who does not know what he is doing? Like a father in the family. You cannot be a double-minded person. A mother. A student who is studying. His school, his college, his postgraduate, his doctorate. How did he get there? When this boy is not able to finish his school. Some out of the garden of the college, he's a worse student. Why? Why? What's the difference between these two young people? One is single-minded. The one says to himself, I'll put all my efforts, all my energy, because I want to become a PhD doctor in my life. It doesn't matter who my father is. It doesn't matter that I come from a small family. It does not matter. Because I have set my mind to achieve the goal. Whereas this one, maybe coming from a rich family. But the problem is he cannot make up his mind. I want to challenge you today. If you are a double-minded person, repent. It's not easy to change the gear from double-mindedness to single-mindedness. It takes time. It takes a lot of work, but it can be done. Because God is looking for single-minded people. If you are double-minded, now you know the reason why God is not blessing you. You're complaining all the time, God is not giving me, look at him, look at her, they're all blessed, look at me, I've got no blessing. You know why? Ask yourself, oh, it is my double-mindedness. It is my lack of commitment. It is my desire not being able to follow through. That's why we are not able to do it. Amen? I want to touch on from Old Testament, two men. And from the New Testament, two people. One achieved the goal. The other one, because of double-mindedness, could not achieve the goal. One is in the book of Genesis. It is Abraham and Lot. Lot was a nephew, Abraham's brother's son, because brother died. God called Abraham, and Lot was going with Abraham. God didn't call Lot, because God knew he's going to be a problem for Abraham. But that's what happened. I'm going to cut short the story because I don't have much time with me. They traveled. Always tension between Lot's servants and Abraham's servants. And God blessed Lot because of Abraham. He also has got lots of cattle and camels and sheep. Not as much as Abraham. What happened? One day Abraham said, well, this is enough. We cannot move forward like this. He said to his, he calls him my brother. We make a decision today. You go whichever way and I'll go the opposite. And I always wondered, you know, what would have happened if if Lot decided to go through towards Canaan, then Abraham will be in trouble, but it's not going to happen because Lot is a double-minded person. He cannot make up his mind. So he chose the nice, flowing, water-flowing, fertile land of Sodom and Gomorrah. He stayed there in the middle of the wicked and perverse generation. It's so hard to explain the sin of that place. God decided to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. You know, Abraham was bargaining with God, starting with 50 righteous. He came up to 5. There was nobody except Lot. And the angels went to Sodom and Gomorrah. Listen to me carefully. And the angels told Lot, this is what we're going to do. God is going to destroy this place. And it says Lot was lingering. He was not willing to go. And the angels had to pull them out. One angel taking the hands of Lot and his wife. And the other angel holding on to 2 daughters. He dragged them out of Lot, out of Sodom, and said, run to the mountains. Don't look back. So Lot says, listen to this. This is double-mindedness. Lot said, no, not that, Lord. Something will kill me in the mountain. So let me run to that village so that I can live there peacefully, a place called Soar. And the angel got so fed up of this double-minded. He said, okay, go. He's running a little bit and he said, no. I don't want to go to Soar. Let's go back to the mountain. He's running again to the mountain. And God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. The wife turned and looked, and she became a pillar of salt. I want to finish up the story. This is in Genesis chapter 19. What do you see? I don't want to explain what happened because you can read, you know. His 2 daughters used their father as a man to bring forth generations. And you know what happened? Lot became the father of 2 cursed generations. And you don't hear anything more about Lot. That is how his life finished. What happened to Abraham? His eyes were set upon the promised land that God is building for him. And he moved on. He inherited the land. He became the father of the nations. He became the friend of God. How? Because his eyes were set upon God. He was a single-minded person, and Lot was a double-minded person. I want you to look at one more. 2 group of people in the New Testament. It is in the book of Acts. And we read in verse 5. This is the time there was a revival of the early church. The Holy Ghost came. God anointed the people. Even at that time, people were believing that Jesus was coming back so soon. That's what they thought. They didn't want to care about anything in this world. They didn't want anything in this world. They said, let's just wait for his coming. And the Bible says they sold everything. They brought it. And they put it at the feet of the apostles. There's big cooking going on. People were eating, community living, because they didn't care about their own houses anymore, their property, their business. They didn't care about anything. And everybody sold. And we read in verse 5, there was a man by name Ananias and his wife Sapphira. What did they do? They also got excited. They also wanted to do the same others were doing. Only thing is, they had too much of land and properties and money. So they sold everything. And they put it in a big suitcase, so much of money. They looked at each other. And then I said to Sapphira, what do you think? So Sapphira says, I'm thinking the same you're thinking. What was their thought? They said, there's too much of money, so let's keep something for ourselves. So just in case if anything goes wrong, we won't be left with anything. Packed up the bags, took half of the money, kept away. She said to her, you go forward. I'll dress up nicely and come. There's going to be a great time. Ananias brought the money, opened the suitcase in front of Peter. You know, God is so amazing. God does not look at the things that you give him, but God looks at the things that you have kept away from him. Isn't that so amazing? That's the difference between a pastor and God. I'll be so excited if you bring me a bunch of money. Oh, praise the Lord. God bless them. But God will say, no, where did you steal my money? God is more concerned about the money you kept away from him. We know the story. He said, is it all? And then he said, yes, look at all the money. And Peter said, why did you do this? Before you sold it was yours? After you sold it was yours. Why did you steal God's money? And when he said that, he fell down and died. You lied to the Holy Spirit. And Sapphira came, the same thing. She was lying again. By the time the young man has buried, Ananias come back. And he said, they will take you as well. So she falls down and dies. And they take her and they bury her. Double-minded people. Some people are like this, giving to God, they're double-minded. They get all excited and worried about all the money that we're giving to God. That's Ananias and Sapphira. Just go one chapter ahead, before, in chapter 4. We read in verse 36 and 37. And Joseph, who was also named Barnabas, by the apostle, which is translated son of the encouragement, a Levite of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it, and brought the money, and laid it at the apostles' feet. This is another person. Single-minded person, Barnabas. He didn't care. He brought all the money, put it at the feet of God. What happened to him? He became one of the greatest apostles. He was the man instrumental to bring Saul. When he became Paul, he brought him to Peter and John. And you read in the early times, it was mentioned in the Bible like Barnabas and Paul. And only later on, it became Paul and Barnabas. Barnabas became one of the greatest apostles with other people. You know why? He was a single-minded person. What do you want to be today? On this Lord's Day, would you tell the Lord God, I don't want to be double-minded. I don't want to be unstable in all my ways. I don't want to lose all my blessings. But I look at you, Lord. I want to be like Abraham. I want to be like Barnabas, so that God's name will be glorified. Heavenly Father, we praise you and we thank you, Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your goodness, Lord. Thank you for speaking to our hearts. Truly, a single-minded person is so close to the Lord's heart. I pray that this message will touch and penetrate the hearts of every one of us. Make us to be men and women, not as double-minded, but single-minded people following the Lord Jesus Christ. I bless everyone today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you, my dear friends. May the Lord take care of you. Love the Lord. God be with you.